Hello, I'm Seema Kumar, and you're watching Eureka Moments. 40 years ago, a novel virus sent shockwaves through the world. People were falling mysteriously ill, many of them dying within months. Doctors weren't able to find out or weren't sure where this new virus came from or how it was spread. One thing they did know was that a positive diagnosis was almost certainly a death sentence. I'm talking about acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, more commonly known as AIDS. It's hard to believe that it's been 40 years since the virus emerged. In that time, it's caused unthinkable tragedy. 79 million people have contracted HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, and more than 36 million of them have died. But along with the staggering suffering and loss of life, we've also seen great medical innovation and cause for hope. We've made huge strides in preventative measures and treatment regimens. According to the United Nations program, UNAIDS, there's been a 64% decrease in AIDS since the peak of the epidemic in 2004. That's good news, at least here in the United States and Europe. But in parts of the world, sub-Saharan Africa, for example, we know that challenges remain. And there are many people, though, working on the front lines and working on solutions. We started Eureka Moments to learn about the people behind the headlines, to get to know the scientists, the healthcare professionals who dedicate their lives to changing the world for the better. On today's show, we're speaking with some of the people who have worked to make HIV history. Later in the show, I'll talk to Johnson & Johnson's chief scientific officer, Dr. Paul Stoffels, who has devoted much of his life to HIV research, and we'll meet a nurse from one of the first wards dedicated to treating AIDS patients in the early 1980s. But first up, we welcome microbiologist and epidemiologist Zeda Rosenberg. Zeda and her team focus on developing preventative efforts to empower women. I'm pleased to have her here today. Welcome. Zeda, welcome.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
It is so great to have you. In sub-Saharan Africa, 63% of new HIV infections are found in women. Why are women in sub-Saharan Africa at such a great risk and greater risk for infection?
Well, many women around the world don't have autonomy in their personal lives, in their sexual reproductive health lives. And it's very difficult for them to say no to unsafe sex, and therefore they're at much greater risk for HIV infection.
You know, that's something that we have learned over time, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, due to the sort of social and behavioral elements in the society that they are at such higher risk. When did you realize that this was a huge problem and that there was a big gap between how men and women were being treated?
It was pretty early on in the HIV epidemic. I mean, I think we almost knew in the late 1980s, early 1990s, that women were going to bear the brunt of this epidemic, just like in other sexually transmitted infections. Just because of the physiology of the sex act, women often receive during sex more of the pathogens that cause sexually transmitted infections. And HIV was no different. And so we kind of knew that this was going to be happening and that it would likely be happening worldwide, not just in sub-Saharan Africa, but clearly that women there were at greater risk.
So yes, there is a huge difference in terms of the transmission and there's a gap, but what about treatments? Are there any gaps in how women are treated versus men are treated or diagnosed?
Well, I think actually in some cases, women do better in treatment and diagnostics because they often will seek medical care more than men will. And so from that perspective, I think treatment is certainly as effective. I think maybe women experience a little bit more stigma from family and friends, so that might make it very difficult. But certainly I think there are discrepancies in the access to HIV prevention, especially early on in the epidemic.
Yeah, and you know, you though had a Eureka moment, and I wanted to actually ask you about that big Eureka moment that actually changed the way you started working, especially with a focus on empowering women to prevent transmission of HIV. So talk a little bit about your Eureka moment first.
Well, it was a collective Eureka moment, I should add, that there are women activists around the world, both in sub-Saharan Africa and in the developed world, were all thinking about how we can help women. And it was the work of the Global Campaign for Microbicides and a pioneer in HIV prevention, Zena Stein, who recently passed away at the age of 99. She had co-authored an editorial to talk about HIV prevention for women. And I think there were many of us activists, scientists and feminist scientists that saw that this was a huge need. And so we worked with the advocates and activists to try to come up with approaches that women might want to use to protect themselves, because telling people then to use male or female condoms was really not under a woman's control. It was under their sex partner's control.
Yeah, and so you started International Partnership for Microbicides, and you began to look for solutions in which women could discreetly figure out a way to, you know, in an empowered way, protect themselves from transmission of HIV. So tell us about IPM and the work that you began to do.
There was a lot of work going on. The microbicide field was actually still rather small and very much underfunded. And there was a lot of work going on with gels, vaginal gels that women could use, and they would need to use it every time they had sex. And that was posing a challenge for women, especially in the clinical trials, to be able to keep all of these gels in applicators, et cetera. And we thought there's gotta be a better way. And there were vaginal rings on the market for contraception and for hormone replacement. And we looked at one of those rings and said, what if we adapted this for HIV prevention so that a woman could insert a vaginal ring that released a highly active antiviral drug and kept it in place for hopefully an extended amount of time, so that she didn't have to think about it every day. And she didn't have to carry anything around with her, so it could be discreet. And that was the notion of the vaginal ring for HIV prevention. And we started doing a few experiments because we weren't sure whether we could get the antiviral drugs in the ring, and more importantly, get them out of the ring, whether women would use it. And we started doing acceptability studies and studies to see whether the drug would come out of the ring. And to our surprise, it actually came out of the ring quite well. And then about four versions later, in terms of getting a drug to be stable in the ring and having a long shelf life for African environments, we were able to design a ring that we could take forward into phase three efficacy trials. And I think one of the eureka moments in all of this was we really had trouble finding manufacturers to make the ring for us and to kind of do a lot of that design work. And so we ended up kind of setting up our own manufacturing facility for the ring. And, you know, and I do remember that day when all of our leadership team was together and we were talking about, well, how are we going to do this if we can't find anybody? And I remember saying very naively, well, how hard is it to make a ring? And they explained all of the vagaries. And I said, well, you know, and they said, well, we need to bring in a one-ton ring press and we'll have to raise the roof literally of this little manufacturing facility we had for gels. And I said, sure, let's do it. And you know, when their horrified looks went away, everyone went about the task of getting it done. So it was great.
That's excellent. Now, you know, that's what we talk about when we talk about Eureka moments, is that when you have the Eureka moment, it's not enough to have that moment, right? But you actually followed through, you persevered. How long did it finally take to where you are today, Zeda?
Oh, it took a long time. 15 years. You know, it took 15 years of plodding through in some cases, because, you know, we are a nonprofit. Our organization is a nonprofit product developer. We don't have a very big bank account, and so we had to raise the funds. It was, you know, building the boat and sailing it at the same time, and we were bailing a lot of water as we went. But it ended up, and I think perseverance is right. The IPM team is the most stubborn, successful group of people I've ever met and have had the pleasure and privilege of working with. So it was this great team effort to get this work done.
That is extraordinary. So congratulations for bringing forward, you know, a solution for women, especially in Sub-Saharan Africa. Now, what do you see as the future of HIV/AIDS, and where do you think the community is going, and where do you see the biggest opportunities to make a difference?
Well, I think, first of all, young people are at the highest risk of HIV infection. And we know, and we've learned through every disease on the planet, that it is challenging to have young people recognize their risk and either prevent or even treat infections often. And so addressing the needs of young people, especially in an area where there is stigma in terms of having sex at a young age, there are, you know, healthcare providers don't want to talk to 16 and 17 year olds about sex because they just think you shouldn't be having sex. So therefore you can't be at risk. And I think we need to have, especially young women, feel comfortable, feel safe, feel like their needs are being met, they're being listened to. And so I think this whole approach for both treatment and prevention for young people is going to be critical. And, you know, I find it kind of interesting that the older I get, the more I think about young people, not just in kind of leading all of our efforts going forward, but they are so smart and so resourceful, and we've just got to listen to what they need.
That is such great words of wisdom, and you know, and particularly poignant as we approach tomorrow, World AIDS Day, you know, 40 years of HIV. Thank you, Zeda. Thank you for this inspiring conversation and for all the work that you're doing to ensure equitable treatment for women in Sub-Saharan Africa and all around the world. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
I've had the pleasure of working alongside Zeda and also, of course, Dr. Paul Stoffels at Johnson & Johnson. He's a chief scientific officer. He's been that for the past 17 years. And while Paul has taken on, you know, numerous important medical challenges over the course of his career, his dedication and work on HIV is one of his greatest legacies. And as a young doctor in Africa, his quest for answers led him to a 40-year journey. Last week, I had the opportunity to sit down with Paul and talk to him about his relentless quest to find a cure for HIV.
Paul, welcome back to Eureka Moments. This year, world marked 40 years since HIV was first identified, and tomorrow is World AIDS Day. It's an international day dedicated to raising awareness of the AIDS pandemic and mourning those who have lost their lives, but also celebrating the successes that we've had in solving HIV. As someone who began your career first as a doctor in Africa, just when HIV was first emerging, can you share what it was like in those early days?
Well, it was really challenging. When I first came in Africa in 83, you had already the first patients who HIV was recently discovered as a virus and was 3 years known as a disease. And we only saw very sick patients with a very short life expectancy having multiple different infections. And we really didn't know what to do. People lived only a few months and many people were infected. So it was, let's say, disastrous because many top people from government and nobody knew how the disease could spread that fast all died, and it had a huge impact. When I came later, I came back every year, and when it went into the late 80s, very high percentage of people were dead, but also a lot of orphans because their parents died. And so the societal impact of HIV was dramatic on the African continent in those days, with no solutions at all. Some infectious disease products to treat some infections, but there were very limited possibilities. The only thing people could do at that moment is prevention campaigns and try to prevent transmission.
Yeah, my, how far we have come. Now, you pivoted from being an HIV doctor to actually going into research on HIV. What made you cause that shift?
I got to know Dr. Paul Janssen, who was a very famous researcher in medicines, and he told me, like, let's start research here. One day we'll solve the disease with one pill once a day, and people will lifelong, and it will be available to everybody. And I said, the guy is crazy. This is never going to happen. And so he said, you should start. Let's start working on it. Never give up, and you will see. One day we'll get there. And it was that mission of Dr. Janssen where I stepped in. Let's work together on making this happen.
And now you started two companies side by side at the same time, Tibotec and Verco. One was on therapeutics, one was on diagnostics. Why was it important to venture into both at the same time?
I worked several years with Dr. Janssen. We made several new drugs and an RTI inhibitors, which were the first type of antivirals, and they didn't work. But we didn't know why they didn't work as single agent. But very quickly we figured out they all caused very quickly the virus to mutate and not respond anymore. So 2 weeks after we gave such a new drug, it was not active anymore on the virus. And that brought me to, we need to go and diagnose resistance. And so I founded a company called Verco. We did phenotyping on viruses, and we learned which patient responded to what drug and tried to make combinations to make that effective. But that learned us that we needed to have also new drugs, which were active on multi-drug resistant strains. And we started to use the patient virus, which we learned which came from the testing, to figure out on how can we make combinations and then how can we make new drugs. And that led to new medicines, which really were transformational on the disease. And so from resistance testing, combining that with drug discovery, that was the why we did two companies and got to those results.
It was a juxtaposition of those two that actually led to the Eureka moment.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. We could never have got to the new drugs if we would not have done the diagnostic work.
That's incredible. So, you know, it took you a long time, though, to actually start from, you know, when you're looking at patients and when you started to make drugs, to getting to one pill once a day. So what was that journey like?
Well, it took us at least 16, 17 years. We started with new drugs where we gave 18 pills twice a day to people. But they survived. It was a very complicated type of combination therapy, but we survived. And we took then the next 10 years to simplify. And so so we got to single pill once a day, and now even we jumped further, we were able to make a single injection once every month, and even once every second month. Jointly with GSK Vif, we were able to make a combination which now can be given 6 injections a year. And so that took 30 years from the first discovery of the NNRTI to now having the once every second month injection, 30 years.
Wow, yeah. But of course, there were a lot of good milestones in between. But it takes that long to go from one pill once a day to now a long-acting injectable that patients can take. But still, that's not enough, is it?
Well, it's not enough. We should find a cure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But today, mm-hmm. I think Thank we you. Can be very happy that we are to the point that people can live lifelong, healthy life, if they can comply with their medication. But curing is the next step. We tried to work, and we still work on a vaccine. It's very difficult. Our first try with a study in Bokodo in South Africa had positive results, but not strong enough to continue. The study Mosaico, which is going on globally, is still testing the HIV vaccine in MSM, and so we'll try to figure out, does it work? Next step on the cure, how can you get to really the new science which is available now on trying to get to a cure for HIV? And I think we'll never give up. We'll continue to both work on the vaccine and on the cure and try to find the next step in for this disease.
And finding an HIV vaccine has been the holy grail for such a long time. And, you know, people have been looking for it for such a long time. When we had the COVID pandemic, still do, we were able to actually make four different types of vaccines in record time, in about a year. Why has it not happened for HIV?
HIV is a virus which is a million times smarter than COVID. COVID is a simple respiratory virus, which is very effective on infecting massive number of people over in the world. Also quite simple to make a vaccine against. And so that was done very quickly. When the code was available, the spike protein was the clear target that was used in many different vaccines and now also as target for antibodies and other interventions. And very quickly we got to it. But the challenge is not just, it is a simple virus. Worldwide there's the infection, where HIV was limited as an infection to a certain population, mainly in Africa and a certain part of the population in the West. COVID is affecting everybody. And that's where we have the big challenge on the global scale to implement the prevention and treatment to make sure that we can control the pandemic.
But you're still optimistic that we will have an HIV vaccine.
I think we never should give up. When we started with HIV medicines, the first time we failed, the second time we failed, and we had to stay optimistic from we are going to get there. Every time you fail, you learn. And in pharmaceutical industry, that's you, as long as you succeed more than you fail, you can survive. And so we have done that in many diseases and we'll continue to look for the solution.
Let's talk about access and health equity. So, you know, here, of course, in the United States and many Western countries, HIV has become a manageable condition, you know, with one pill once a day. In places like Africa and many other parts of the world that are, you know, underprivileged, under-resourced, that is not the case. What are the solutions to actually get access to HIV medicines for patients worldwide?
The world did a massive effort to make HIV drugs available. And so through PEPFAR and the Global Fund, through the industry providing access to generic forms of the medicines, even all the combinations, that led to a solution where, in principle, everyone in the world should get access. It's a matter of course, a massive implementation activity in the healthcare systems, which are not always able to cope with that type of daily pill, and people have to come regular to visits. But I think we have gone a very long path and made a very advanced way into being able to treat the majority of the world. It still can go better. The challenge is also we need to continue it. It's because HIV medication, people need to take it lifelong. We'll have to continue the support programs, the hospitals will have to, and the clinical practices will have to deal with it for the next 30, 40, 50 years. And that will be the challenge, to give people normal life expectancy. You will have to treat everyone lifelong. And I think the world did a very good job on getting there, but maintaining it is going to be a big task.
What are the lessons learned from, you know, all the work that has gone on in HIV that can be applied to other diseases?
Then several things. First, a very strong collaboration between public and private. HIV was a pandemic in its days. We worked together with academia, with government, with NIH, with FDAs, with regulators on how can we accelerate the access to new medicines. And first of all, the biomarkers were introduced. We got our products eventually approved on viral load, not on disease markers anymore. And that helped to accelerate first the development of the drugs, and second then the combinations.
Now patients played a huge role, and a lot of things happened in HIV that were firsts, industry firsts, government firsts, right? So some lessons learned from there?
Yeah, it was thanks to patient pressure that the world accelerated big time on new solutions and on drugs. And first, we learned that we had to have biomarkers to make sure we could develop. The first drugs were tested on clinical endpoints. It took long, it was complicated, and you didn't want to measure number of deaths to know whether your product worked. So very quickly, viral load became like the marker that helped to develop new drugs, new combinations, and had very big impact. Second was the public-private partnership with regulators on how to accelerate, and the breakthrough designation and accelerated review was invented with HIV. It was there to accelerate time to result, and we could get drugs approved based on the on phase 2B clinical trial. It was the first time in history that that happened. And that was that gave us then the ability to go fast. And then the next collaboration was how to bring it to the world. And there, working together with generic companies in India, in other parts of the world, to transfer the technology, transfer the capabilities and the science, to make sure they could make it at a very cheap price, and with that bring it to the African continent and to the developing nations. All of that was like a revelation. This was a blueprint for how to collaborate on COVID, could be and is a blueprint how to collaborate on cancer and on dementia. Yeah, big diseases in the world which still need great solutions, important solutions. That is the blueprint. HIV learned us how to do it.
So tomorrow is World AIDS Day. And if you think about the young physician who started his career in Africa, Dr. Stoffels, what would you tell him?
Do again what you did. I think I would not have changed almost anything in what I did in my life. It was always with the passion of making the difference for patients, the joy on getting the result, and the joy of having the impact on life and seeing people survive a long time. I travel often to Africa. We did the same. We did a new drug for TB. We were able to change the treatment of multidrug-resistant TB almost everywhere in the world. It is that result in the end, if you see that in the world, on how you can have impact on life with good science, that is why you do it. And I would not change a bit of what I've done in my life.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Paul. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Seema.
Thank you again, Paul. Speaking with Zeda and with Paul, it's clear how much we've learned over the past several years and how far we've come in the past 40 years, but also how far we still have to go. Our next guest was there at the very beginning of the AIDS epidemic and is here to share with us her story. When AIDS first emerged, there was a tremendous amount of fear and stigma, even within the healthcare community, which led to many people who are not willing to take care of the sick and dying HIV patients. Alison Moed was a nurse who refused to let fear and stigma impact her care. She and the team from the very first AIDS ward in San Francisco were featured in the award-winning documentary, Ward 5B.
They wanted to quarantine us on an island.
I had seen patients being marginalized, and I just found it infuriating.
People were like, well, you're probably going to get AIDS, and you're probably going to die. I'm more pissed off and angry than I am scared. We have to do something.
At San Francisco General, the staff is opening up a special wing to treat AIDS victims.
It was built by the nurses there.
We were gay, we were straight, we were young, we were old.
We decided if we can't save these folks, we're going to touch them.
This was a tangible thing you could do. Wash them, put moisturizer on them.
So much in life is not what you say or what you do, it's how you make people feel.
You don't have to have a hazmat suit every time you're around an AIDS person. You don't have to burn their bed because they died.
It's brought change for how hospitals work.
The nurses were the real heroes.
They stood up when nobody else would, and they were willing to take those risks.
Wow. What a movie. And if you think back to those days, early days of HIV and AIDS, it's easy to forget how much fear and stigma there was actually, and how little knowledge and how little we knew about the virus that causes HIV, AIDS, or AIDS, I should say. We didn't know anything. And it is just such a testament to the scientific community all around the world that we've come as far as we have come, but also to the healthcare community, to the nurses, to the doctors, but also the patients and the advocacy community and the families that all have brought us here today. And I am really pleased now to welcome one of the people who was actually featured in the film, Nurse Alison Moed. Alison, welcome to the show.
Thank you, I'm honored to be here and with you and my esteemed colleagues, thank you.
So Alison, as I said, we've come so far in our knowledge and treatment of HIV and AIDS that it's easy to forget what those early days were like. I mean, this clip really took me back to the beginning of it all. I mean, we all watched this unfold on the television news, but you were right there at the very heart of it. I mean, how does watching this clip make you feel? I mean, what memories does it bring back for you?
I would say it certainly brings back great sadness, even after all those years. And I think that the sadness will probably remain with me till the end of my life. It brings back feelings of love. It brings pride for the work that we were able to accomplish. And memories, remembrances of that time, of those people that who were our patients and who we became very close to.
That is, such an indelible feel and memory that it leaves you behind with. What were some of the challenges at the beginning? Do you think those challenges are around even today?
I think that those challenges do exist, not only in regard to HIV, but also in regard to COVID-19. There are similarities between the two. But first of all, there was great fear. There was fear of this unknown disease. When the unit opened, the virus had not yet been identified. We didn't actually know there was definitely surmise, but we didn't know what the causative agent or even exactly what the route of transmission was. So there was a lot of fear that even those of us who were leaping forward to do this care, to take part in this mission of giving good care, we had a great deal of fear. And then there was certainly fear in the communities that were affected. So there was also the political challenges. We were very fortunate in San Francisco that our local government identified that there was a problem affecting the citizenry and would name it and acknowledge and take steps to make changes as we found out what changes could be made in our approach. But nationally, there was not a lot of recognition. In fact, it took years before the words AIDS were even mentioned. And we've seen a lot of the same sort of thing happening today, where there's been a lot of controversy and politicization of a disease. So that was another, though that was and that remains another challenge. And then there was the challenge to reach the communities that were affected. There was a sort of, well, it's not going to happen to me attitude in many communities, or the idea that it would only affect certain populations. We're seeing the same thing happen now today. Yeah. And and then there did become an issue of trust of the healthcare community. How, when a disease affects a stigmatized population, do you create an environment where that members of that population feel comfortable in coming in to get the early care and treatment that they need to address symptoms that are troubling, which may or may not be part of the disease, to get education about this as it exists, about these unknown factors. So we saw that then, and we're also seeing that now.
Yeah. I mean, that's such an important point, trust, because I think that underlies all of it, doesn't it? Even the quality of care you get, the quality of care that is given. Now, in the documentary, we're reminded, you know, how HIV patients were treated at that time, you know, quite badly, inhumane treatment. How do you think that you're standing up and actually stepping in, you and so many others who took care of these patients? How did that change you as a person, and how did it help shape your career as a nurse?
Well, you know, as a nurse, I entered the profession out of a desire to give care, out of a recognition of my humanity, and that within me, there was a driving force that wanted me to interact with other humans and in this caring way. And I think that's part of the motivation for all nurses who come into the profession. One of my, in a sense, Eureka moments, and I think I speak about it a little in the film, was the realization that maybe not all care providers feel this way towards all members of every community. So that there was certainly stigma towards members of the gay community at that time. And I heard that articulated. And so that strengthened in me my own resolve for justice in healthcare. And how could I, little Alison, you know, who's just a nurse, as we used to say, how could I really play a role and what kind of power did I have, and how could I grow that power to give good care, to democratize healthcare, to make a healthcare setting that was trustworthy and responsive to patients' needs, no matter their backgrounds, socioeconomic, cultural, no matter the color of their skin, no matter their sexual partner, or how they identified themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that was a big Eureka moment for you about, you know, the power just within you to actually give care and grow. And, you know, that's just such a remarkable, remarkable story. The documentary itself, do you think it has brought new awareness to a younger generation?
Yeah, I would say it has. I've had the opportunity to hear from many young people who were affected. Sometimes people friend me on Facebook or send me messages because they've seen the film and they want to thank me, or they want to thank our group, and they want to tell me about the difference that the film has made in their lives. Sometimes these are people from the gay community or a community of color. I've had people from the Philippines or from other foreign countries writing to me and saying, thank you so much. Or maybe in our country, we don't have these opportunities, you know, but thank you for making me aware. And I've heard from people who are nurses and other healthcare providers saying, I'm going to bring these lessons into my work of today, are inspired by what you guys did, and we want to continue the traditions that you've begun of caring, of healthcare justice and equity.
That is phenomenal. What a great story and what a great inspiration, Alison, you are. And it's wonderful to hear that the younger generation is feeling inspired to actually enter into the same profession in terms of creating, you know, giving care, creating trust, and in enhancing equity. Thank you, Alison, for being with us and for sharing your story, your work, and your experience with us. Really appreciate your being on the show.
Thank you.
Well, looking at the last 40 years of research and treatment and all of that, it's clear that we've made remarkable progress and strides. But for those with access to life-saving treatments, while AIDS has become a manageable disease, we still have a long way to go to making the treatments accessible, but also eliminating HIV forever. Because despite all research, progress, and education, 1.5 million people are still diagnosed with HIV globally each year, and 37,000 of those right here in the United States. There is still a lot more work to be done. Our guests today have left me with some great sense of hope for the future. And for each guest we spoke with today, I know there are thousands more working towards the same goal. The goal being eliminating HIV and AIDS forever and making HIV history. Scientists continue to work relentlessly towards making this possible. The wonder of science is that we're always learning and building on research and knowledge. To move forward and achieve a cure for AIDS, COVID-19, or any number of other diseases out there, we must support and the people who are behind the scenes who are working tirelessly and often thanklessly to change the world. This show is a contribution to that process. One of those people who worked tirelessly is Dr. Paul Stoffels, and it has been a privilege to have worked so closely with him over the years. And Paul has not only been a champion for the world, a champion for people, a champion for HIV, a champion for COVID, but he's also been one of the best bosses ever, leading people and influencing people to actually do more than just take care of themselves, but to take care of the people, the communities, and also the world. I hope that today's show filled you with such inspiration and a lot of hope as it did for me. If it has, I encourage you to subscribe to our channel for more Eureka moments. And tomorrow, as the world celebrates World AIDS Day, we hope you'll remember some of our guests and how their work has made an impact on everyone who's been touched by HIV. Thank you for joining us today. See you next week.